Hey guys, Janus here. In today's video, I'll be talking about something called vortical compression. In my time spent studying the cardiovascular system, I became clued into its heavy reliance on fluid mechanics, specifically water mechanics. Because of H2O's molecular properties, it cannot help but spiral when made to interact with either itself or other molecules, and this base molecular property is reflected throughout the whole of nature. Given this highly fundamental hallmark, I made studying water-based flow patterns a focal point of my work. One of the first things you must understand about water is that it's at its most dense while in a liquid form. This means that it's all but impossible to compress it any further. This is one of the reasons why water has such an amazing ability to act like a solid when suddenly displaced at high speeds, or how when absorbed into a hydrophilic structure can create non-Newtonian solids, such as oobleck, for instance. If you've never seen oobleck videos, they are definitely worth the watch. Taking into account water's inability to be compressed, even while in a liquid form, and its natural propensity to spiral, you end up with a bizarre set of circumstances that allow for nothing short of a miracle. Anytime water is made to move about, it breaks and reforms hydrogen bonds instantaneously. Far more than that, though, they do so in a highly orderly pattern that resembles strings of pearls. Water molecules love to arrange themselves into vortical sphere-based shapes that effortlessly string or stack together. Think water droplets. For instance, even when water is sitting perfectly still inside of a container, even if you cannot readily perceive it with your own eyes, the mass within is rife with perfect spheres and long undulating chains of water molecules. The easiest way to see these spheres and chains is when water is poured out onto a surface and allowed to flow along a gradient. Seemingly without cause, it will form these long, winding, spiraling chains or near perfectly round droplets. The second way you can see these water-based structurations, specifically the water chains, is by watching a vortex. For instance, should water be stirred with a magnetic array, you can easily see the water chains grasping at the spinning object. One end will be winding about the spinning magnet, for instance, while the other end will be whipping about along the top at great speed. And therein lies the magic trick. By making water move in just about any manner, you will cause it to spin because of its base molecular properties, but if you make water spin like you would with a vortex, or make it interact with a circular tube, you can accentuate and amplify this effect. While I was studying the heart, I came to discover it basically functions as a force multiplier, a spiral engine. Blood enters the heart through a narrowed tube which accentuates and amplifies its propensity to form long undulating chains. Then, once it enters the chamber, based on the angle of incidence, it spreads out over the walls of the heart in a spiraling pattern, a vortex. Then, the heart opens its valves and the blood is forcibly sucked from its chamber by the arterial system. As the pressure within the heart drops, the cardiac muscle contracts in a passive fashion. This contraction acts upon the previously formed water chains. Just as a well-timed motion with your arm and wrist propagates down the length of a whip to make its end move faster than the speed of sound, the relatively slow contractions of the heart act upon the water chains in a very similar manner, greatly increasing the rate at which blood spirals as it leaves. This spiraling imparts an enormous amount of benefits, the most interesting being flow stability and reach. Now, what I'm going to say is going to be a little controversial, but I believe the size of the heart is directly linked to body mass index, and it relates to vortex size and therefore the end speed of these water whips. Whenever we are growing, the heart will undergo these sudden growth spurts before we grow in size. In adulthood, I'm curious if the equation flips. As body mass goes up, does the heart get bigger, or is the relationship still the same in that the heart will get bigger before we necessarily could get bigger? And I'll be perfectly honest in saying that I've reached somewhat of a dead end in this regard, but I do hope to know the answer before long. In the meantime, I've taken great pleasure in studying how arterial networks do the same thing as the heart, but on a smaller scale with the help of the venous system, but that is for a different time because that's a lot of mechanics. For now, I'll leave you with a neat experiment. If you would like to feel blood spiraling in your body, take your pulse on the underside of your wrist. Close your eyes and try and apply pressure with only one finger. And what you should be able to feel is not just the arterial wall being distended, but you should be able to feel it rolling. You should be able to feel your pulse rolling through that arterial chamber's length. I remember the first time I felt that, I was like, what is that? So hopefully you have a similar experience as myself. I know that in this video, I'd plan to cover a little bit about the macropulse, but I think I'll need to make that a separate video for the simple fact that I need to explain the relationship between veins and arteries before I can do that, and that will take a bit of time. Specifically, I need to explain what flow locking is. That's pretty trippy stuff. But until then, I'd strongly encourage men to begin applying the macropulse squeeze just below the glands instead of the base. It's part of some efforts I've been putting towards refining its technique. Well, guys, that's it for this week's video. Until next time, Janus out.